Good afternoon. I'm very happy to quote Ursula Dumont and Nabil Ahmed. Today is a very special day because we're having this opening lecture by Signoric Borneo and other forests. And then we are opening the video installation, which is the premiere here in Prague, Ursula Dumont's work, which is a video installation Nabil Ahmed also collaborated on. So we are very happy to have this here as on behalf of Fotografesile. I have to say that as we have this topic, Kultura Natura, so your presence is really so important for us because you've been researching and working with topics related to nature, to resources. So Ursula Dumont is an artist, essayist, and she's a writer and also teaches so in Zurich. And I think it's quite difficult to mention all your projects because as your career has been so long, so just I think we can probably focus more on your recent work. And then Nabil Ahmed will present his recent work on other forests as he's a researcher, writer, and educator too. And for instance, I'm very curious, it's a pity we don't have this topic of forensic architecture. I would be so curious about it because but unfortunately, it's not the topic of today.
I will talk about it.
Really?
Yeah.
That's so great.
So,
I'm looking forward.
It's all good.
Is there something else I should mention then? There are so many things.
not for me. That's fine.
All right.
For
so, thank you. So I think, thank you. So.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You, thank you for coming.
Yeah.
And I hope you stay till 6 o'clock when we open also the Common House project, which is another part of the exhibiting space. So I think we can begin.
Well, thanks so much, Mariana. It's an honor to be part of this festival, which is a fantastic form of contextualizing this new project that we're going to speak about tonight, which is a new, brand new thing. But then we're also going to speak about some other forest-related projects. And so we have quite a bit of stuff that we're going to present tonight. So Nabil and I, we have been in a conversation actually about numerous projects and content for several years, but this is actually the first time we came together to work on something together. And it began with a field trip to Borneo last summer, the summer a year ago, to Java and South Kalimantan, which is the Indonesian part of Borneo. And Nabil did the sound recordings while I was doing the filming, and we will both present some of the ideas that went into making it. So these remote and inaccessible forests of Borneo are one of the final world frontiers of life sciences. From every exhibition, adventurous biologists bring back hundreds of unknown species, spiders, beetles, termites, and flies. I was struck to hear that the biodiversity in the rainforest is so dense that a single tree can host 950 different species of insects, of which 20% are about specific to that tree species, and you would not find them on any other kind of tree. So these microecologies are highly specialized and short range. The interaction between so many species in one single tree makes them sensitive even to the slightest changes in light, color, heat, vibration, or atmospheric chemistry. We can imagine the insects to be connected to these ambient conditions like sounds to a musical score. Biosemiotic Borneo, a more explicitly sonic than visual project of art, lingers around the giant banyan tree that stands in the Miratus Mountains. In this region, the primary forest has been reduced to a small protected area inhabited by the Miratus Dayak people, while large swaths of land of their surrounding ancestral land has been devoured by logging, palm oil plantations, sprawling, urbanism, and mining. Given that the relationship to the natural environment is so deeply disturbed, our project set out to explore these very meaning-making processes of nature and reflect on our place in them as artists, authors, and researchers. Setting out to generate a sensorial experience that will respond to this insane biodiversity, we wanted to better understand the role of our interaction with the forest through the mediating instruments of microphones, camera, and a low-tech Steadicam. Parallel to this, we were looking at how biologists go about making sense of these forest ecologies by using specific equipment for insect research, wondering whether the ideas that inspired our work were at all applicable to scientific methods and interpretations today. The sensing and sense-making of nature is conducted simultaneously through audiovisual and entomological instruments. The video starts from a philosophical point of view and is, in this sense, neither empiricist nor documentary. It follows to some extent the phenomenological assumption that we cannot have access to the world as it exists. Instead, we perceive different phenomena and then assemble the pieces in our imagination. From a phenomenological perspective, signification is an individual, language-based process that takes place in our brains. For this process project, however, we draw on biosemiotics, which extends the semiotic premises to all living beings. It is based in the idea that life is semiotic in nature. Taking signification outside the linguistic domain has immediate consequences for where and how we understand reality to take place, to manifest, which is a major concern for artistic practice. Biosemiotics conceive the living universe as a set of interactive relational systems that produce meaning on all scales, regardless of the size and complexity of entities. Most importantly, the production of signs and signification is not a human privilege, but is simply part of the process of world-making. An important reference here is Gregory Bateson, an anthropologist and semiotician who said that the mind is not located within a person or an individual's brain. It is circulating within the interactive relational system and is immanent to it. Mind is what happens in the perceptual moment, occurring outside and between bodies. Another interesting reference for me is Adrian Ivakiv, an environmental and film theorist, who builds on these biosemiotic ideas and who points out that it is in these mental ecologies or in these perceptual ecologies where sensory organs and sensations, bodies and forms of mediation become connected in specific ways. Ivakiv sees this node as the realm where meaning is generated and reality comes into being, both in and outside cinema. He speaks in his book, Ecologies of the Moving Image, about this process as world-making, as geomorphic. We identified this as the interactive milieu within and through which our project, Biosemiotic Borneo, could become most effectively involved in a sense and world-making practice. So we start with the smallest unit, the seed. The seed is a non-living body that contains the matrix for the grown-up tree. For centuries, biologists have collected seeds of tropical trees and gathered them taxonomically ordered in impressive herbaria, like the one in the Biodiversity Center of the University of Leiden, where I scanned several dozens of them. Much attention has been given to each and every one of these 3D scans to make them look more alive in their kind of vivid, original appearance. This part of the video focuses on the individual specimen. In fact, they carry their botanical species names. But from an ecological point of view, however, it's more meaningful to take into consideration that a tree can host hundreds of insect kinds, and that every dispersed seed that drops to the forest floor and starts the life of a new tree harvests the potential for a unique sounding and buzzing multi-species ecology. There is a strong sonic dimension of these forest ecologies that Nabil is going to speak about afterwards. In her beautiful book, Chaos, Territory, Art, the philosopher Elisabeth Gross picks up on the writings of biosemiotician Jakob von Uexküll, for whom music is not just a useful metaphor for understanding highly context-specific relations between living elements within a given milieu. It is a literal form through which nature can be understood as dynamic, collective, lived, rather than fixed, categorized, or represented. In Gross' terms, musical composition is what binds together the co-evolution of the tree, the insects, and the birds that live in it. As such, forest organisms don't exist as separate beings, but as beings in refrain. The musical refrain of biosemiotic Borneo has to be understood in this way, as an ensemble of organisms composed of coexisting, overlapping beings and fragments of milieu. I don't know if you're familiar with Jakob von Uexküll's idea of milieu, probably many of you who come to the nature culture. Umwelt. Yeah, beautiful Umwelt. We see an indigenous Dayak scientist preparing a test ground in the field. His empirical operation aims primarily at sensing the biodiversity found in the soil around and under the Bayan tree. The performance reenacts a common scientific practice whereby soil is placed in suspended textile bags. In the course of a few days, living critters make their way down into the bottom where the collection glass is installed. From there, you can determine what lives in that square meters of forest soil. You can speculate what biologists actually do with this assemblage of life that they have extracted from the soil. Traditional biologists would go about their task of naming and describing existing and newly discovered species. I got more interested in recent procedures used by marine microbiologists and ideas based in this sonic knowledge of nature, as we just mentioned above, where scientists are no longer only identifying individual species. Increasingly, they examine the ensemble of living things, plants, insects, fungi, and other organisms, and transcode them into a web of genetic text. Their method seeks to describe entire genetic assemblages as fluid relations. So the video narrative likes to suggest that art, music, and the humanities are guiding scientific methods. Specifically, that the ecological understanding of nature, perception, and the mind has directly impacted the interpretive work of field scientists. It likes to see the commonalities between the humanities and natural science, where efforts are made to converge scientific forms of explanations with the apparitions of living things themselves. Our artistic interaction with the natural world aims not primarily to produce new knowledge about it, but first and foremost to equip non-human existence with specific media technologies that enable their expression in a way that humans can perceive. Through a biosemiotic sampling, if you'd like. So in this project, video and field recordings are not understood as representations of existing reality. They become agents of the semiotic process, unfolding in the interactive, connective dimension among living things and non-living things, in the intimate and intermediary space made of the relations among things, people, practices, and technologies that enable that sense to emerge, of ecologies yet to come, as you said. Okay, so I think I'm going to hand over to you for making some remarks about the sonic dimension.
Well, thanks, Ursula. Again, from my point of view, again, from my perspective, it's I'm very happy to be here. It was my first time in Prague. First of many things. It's the first time working with Ursula on this project. I was very excited when she invited me to join her, to go to Borneo, mainly for two reasons. The first reason being that I'm working now for several years on a long-term project that's located on a conflict in West Papua, which is a militarized territory of Indonesia, just above Australia. We will look at plenty of maps later on, so we leave that for now. So in a sense, Borneo, right, is if you sort of think about the planet, Borneo, Sumatra, and Kalimantan, Sulawesi, and Papua form this massive tropical rainforest, only third alongside this green belt, right, or this green hug that sort of moves around the planet from the Amazon, which we'll speak about in a little bit, in the Congo rainforest. So they're of course of immense ecological, cultural, political importance. So in a sense, to me, going to Borneo, the chance to go to Borneo was a little bit to sort of learn what was happening in that context with not necessarily directly involved, but be sort of in relation to, of course, the local ecology, but also indigenous politics, environmental NGOs, who we were somehow embedded with the time we were there, which was really great. So that's the kind of the political reason, you could say. But secondly, which was even more exciting, was the fact that I could go with a bunch of microphones to sort of accompany Ursula on this trip, and because I'm working for also many years, I grew up playing in bands in the U.S. And also I worked in radio for many years, but I just didn't really have the chance to sort of work with sound in the field like that before. I co-founded a sound art organization in London called Call and Response with some other friends. But this opportunity to sort of be in the forest, a place that we sort of speak about so much, and a tropical forest at that, and to sort of sense this place using microphones was a really amazing opportunity. So we were sort of recording all various times of the day, from the very early morning to the very late, using various microphones that were sort of able to pick up sort of directional sounds that are far away, or really an ambience of a certain place, hydrophones to record under the water, and others. In particular, you will see, in fact, we see it here. This is the very first image of the sequence of the video, I was really feeling terrible that early morning, but nevertheless we sort of soldiered on and made our way to the middle of the jungle at like 4 in the morning, and sort of sat there being sort of attacked by all sorts of insects and just trying to get you to in the same place as me a little bit. So this most sort of and Ursula was there sort of filming, right? And it, I think it this is like sort of like a 20-30 minute sequence that's been sort of, you know, sort of so distilled down to about, I don't know, 1.5 minutes, two minutes. But during this time, right, like it's sort of the forest is silent, no, and then after a little while, just as we imagined, at least I imagine, no, like you start hearing the birds sort of waking up, and it's really a kind of like an epiphany, right, if you know what I mean. There's a quote in the video, and I'll just read it. It says, listening at this threshold to the animal communities in the tropical forest is sensing biodiversity, the chaos of sounds produced in a given place in the forest over time and sonic frequencies. And even though this might seem like the most common sense thing, but when you're sort of in there and you're sort of listening, you sort of really get the sense, right, that here's this tropical forest where there's all of these species and all of these animals and birds and insects, but you cannot see any of them, right? But then you hear them. And it's not, you know, listening or being able to really pay attention and listen a way to, it's a way to know and act in the world. So it is perhaps in some small ways these realizations, right, that perhaps can make us better or more aware ecologists, right? Now, I don't want to make this distinction at the same time. This is only to do with the forest. I think this act of sort of listening, you know, sort of with this sort of attenuation, right, with this intention, with this can be done anywhere. And this is why sound makes for such a powerful medium, in the sense that while at the same time it's very promiscuous, you know, one has to really pay attention and to the barely audible or listen to the inaudible. We can easily translate that to sort of political terms, right? When to the very notion that it is the ability to sort of speak at the table that or for your voice to be heard that one makes one a political subject. So with this idea of this ecology, the sonic ecology of the forest, sort of felt and experienced in the most simple ways, although with some very expensive microphones, we could it sort of allowed to sort of think about, let's say, what could be the structure of the sonic elements of the whole thing. And I was very fortunate to work with a percussionist who we sort of watched all these sequences many times and sort of tried different things and to try to give another sort of sonic dimension, which later Patrick, who is the sound designer that Ursula has worked for many years, did a fantastic job to sort of bring also these electronic sort of elements together. For instance, there's a part in the film, and I was just telling Ursula while we were having a tomato soup for lunch, that there was, well, sort of the day after we arrived, we sat at our lodge where we were staying, and I was sort of sitting there, first time really turning on these microphones called DPA 4060, if you're familiar with. This kind of microphones, and I could really, you know, like just listening to the forest across the river, and I sort of like asked Ursula to come over, and we both listened, and it was just really really special. But there were all these frogs that were making very musical sort of sounds, which was I don't know, I was just fascinated with these sounds of what sounded like frogs, but. But at the same time, you know, the theme of this festival is nature and culture, you know? It's like, but it's like, what you know, we cannot also sort of fix these terms in one place, right? Perhaps in again in a small way, which is what we attempt to do with this video. But I just heard that this would have been perfect for like I don't know if you guys are familiar with this band called Mouse on Mars. In the early 90s, they were on Tupier Records, and they had this they had a series of albums with Tupier. Tupier also at this time had PJ Harvey, Seafield, and many other sort of bands. This one album called Volvoland, and there was a track called Frosch, which means frog in German. And I really, you know, like listening to it, to the frogs across the river, I really heard, right, that somehow reminded me of Mouse on Mars, like this early Mouse on Mars. Sure enough, and this is really not something that we had discussed with Patrick, he heard it, right, in his studio somewhere in Europe, and he was literally putting a bass line that you will hear a few later on in the piece that sounded exactly like also a reference to Mouse on Mars. So that was a really... that made me very happy. So I think we're getting close to the end of this segment, but just before we part, I want to sort of take this opportunity to sketch out a little idea with you. And that is to, and again, it has, I think, plenty to do with, these concepts of of nature and culture. Is that we are? I'll sort of put these two ideas at once, and I'll leave it as a paradox. Really, is one is a notion of inequivalence, right, and the other a non-equivalence. The equivalence being that we are this idea that nature, in many sort of cosmologies and many cultures, is akin, right, akin as in family. I work now very intensively in the Pacific region. I'll tell you about that a little bit later. But where I quote this from a law professor for University of Hawaii, Williamson Chang, who writes in reference to Polynesian cultures, that Polynesian cultures view the oceans as kin and thus part of the extended human family called Ohana in Hawaiian. The ocean is also viewed as the source and residence of other non-human beings that have deep spiritual significance, right? So, you know, we also cannot sort of fetishize a specific ecology, right? So it is this, or specific sort of indigenous peoples. There's many sort of relations and resonances, right, that are all around the world, many cultures. So, but here the point is really this idea of nature as kin, right? As something, as an equivalence that one humans feel to others, to nature. But on the other hand, there's non-equivalence, and that is to think about nature as a wholly other, right? Completely, totally alien from anything that we could ever even begin to understand. A friend of mine, the geographer Anya Kangizer, sort of directed me to a quote from another Ursula Le Guin, the science fiction writer who has sort of resonates with many of you here probably. And I'll read this quote from her. May there not come even that bolder adventurer, the first geolinguist, who, ignoring the delicate trenchant lyrics of the lichen, will read beneath it the still less communicative, still more passive, wholly atemporal, cold volcanic poetry of the rocks. Each one a word spoken how long ago by the earth itself, in the immense solitude, the immenser community of space. The poetry of rocks, right? This notion that we could somehow in this totally atemporality of a nature that does not care, right, about us, to sort of nevertheless try to feel or try to act then politically as ecologists. I hope given the theme of this festival and that there's such an amazing sort of group of people that you guys have sort of well, the organizers of the festival have put together, that I would, you know, kind of put this on the table here. I think I'm done on with that. Do you have any?
No, I think that's points? That's mm-hmm. maybe why you also keep introducing and the non living mm-hmm. into mm-hmm. the text.
Exactly.
Because
yeah.
I took it out because it didn't feel mine. Yeah. But I'm very glad you really expanded on this now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I
we can discuss this also yeah. more at length later, because there yeah. is also a matter of using different references.
Absolutely.
Like, you know,
yeah.
like the forest mm-hmm. sink and so mm-hmm. on. So. Mm-hmm. That's great. So actually that's a very good lead over to forest law, because we're talking about very different cosmologies in this project, and
yeah, exactly,
and different ways of thinking about the relationship of human nature.
I hope we have some time to discuss to
yes,
you know, open
we
up
will,
afterwards,
we
right?
Will.
So I will pass it over to.
Okay. Cool. So Forest Law is another project, a little older, 2014, and it's also a collaborative project designed with Paulo Tavares, who is a Brazilian architect who had been researching the Amazonian space for many years and actually wrote his PhD on this. And I had the good fortune to go with him to the Ecuadorian Amazon, and on a field trip in preparation for this work. So that project started off also a bit on a philosophical conversation between Paulo and I on Michel Serres' beautiful book, The Natural Contract, who actually pleads, that's from 1990, so that's like at the moment of globalization. He actually was aware that with all this tremendous use of resources, this planet is going to be in trouble in no time, and that he was pleading for a natural contract that would supplement and complement the existing social contracts that our legal system is made of. And so this idea of the natural contract, or the rights of nature, has actually become a reality in Ecuador. As many of you probably know, that in 2008 it was inscribed in the constitution, and nature came forth as a subject with rights in front of the law. So the idea for this project was to follow a series of legal cases that would bring the forest to court, and that where the forest itself was a main protagonist, and where these kind of rights of nature were being negotiated and also set precedents for possible other cases in the future. So what was particularly interesting to me in these new laws is that Ecuador extends its jurisdiction to a multi-species population, and by doing so it unhinges human-centric legal conceptions and places them in a wider cosmopolitical context. Indigenous nations in the Amazon speak of the living forest, the selva, la selva viviente, which is a concept that not only concerns the life and reproduction of scientific species, but the living forest ecosystem, including vital but invisible beings, like the masters of the forest, of the river, of the mountains, who are the protectors of life. So it's not just humans who protect nature, but these forest masters take care of that. This way of living and thinking with the forest has come under great pressure now from extractivist desires for oil and minerals. These giant mining and drilling projects and operations are heavily weighing down on this amazing biodiversity. And since most of these territories are actually belong to indigenous nations, obviously it's bound to create conflict and resistance. So forest law concentrate on three legal court cases unfolding in Ecuador. And at the heart of forest law lies a particular case of Sarayaku, a Quechua people who owns a very large territory, very remote, like 150,000 hectares of forest. And they sued the state of Ecuador for letting oil companies invade their land, and they couldn't sue them in the state of Ecuador because it was against the state. So they sued them at the Inter-American Court of Human Rights in Costa Rica. An Argentinian company, oil company, had actually come and laid out kind of that deadly grid of seismic, for a seismic exploration. And you see this map that Paulo Tavares designed that shows the white outlined area is the territory of Sarayaku. And then the yellow blocks are these oil blocks that are licensed by the state to various oil companies. You could just license that land and then you were free to explore. But of course, everyone can see this. There is an overlapping, a huge overlapping area where 60% of Sarayaku territory would now be open to oil exploration. Every one of these yellow dots is an explosive that is buried in the soil, where this is the way you can find out how deep the oil is located in the soil. So they explode this, and then by the vibes and so on, they can understand where the oil is located. Sarayaku was particularly appalled by the fact that there is a special area that is marked here in this pinkish area, where they have made a reservation, they made a reserve of this area for species reproduction. So they don't even go themselves, they consider this like a sacred area. And these oil explorations even cross that land. So based on this, they fought for 10 years and actually won the case a couple of years ago. So another really famous case, just wondering if this could be the right, oh yeah. I wanted to play you this little clip where the chief, the leader of Sarayaku, speaks about the
La selva viviente es la selva de los seres.
De la selva.
La selva de, por donde los micro, macro organismos se intercomunican, se interconectan con nosotros, donde vamos a tomar energía para nuestros emociones psicológicas, físicas, también son espacios donde se transmiten los conocimientos a través de los yachas, a través de los ancianos, hacia los hijos, es una área de educación propia. Y también son zonas donde entramos en comunión con otros seres. Y esos seres nos transmiten las energías vitales para poder vivir, para poder continuar. Y ese es esto la selva viviente. Para nosotros el desarrollo primero y nace desde el respeto a la vida, el respeto a los derechos de los pueblos que estamos viviendo aquí milenariamente, ancestralmente, guardando esta naturaleza. Ahí sale el verdadero concepto del desarrollo. Caso contrario, para nosotros es una agresión, es una imposición, es un genocidio silencioso que va generando poco a poco.
So another famous case that we are referring to in the video is an unresolved case by Chevron and Texaco, who who contaminated a very large area in the north of Ecuador by storing the byproducts of oil drilling in these very large kind of oil pools all over the forest, without insulating the bottom, so that this whole toxic stuff actually ran down into the groundwater. So what unfolds in this remote corner of the rainforest is of worldly importance. What moves to the foreground of our intellectual and artistic attention are the most material concerns. The toxic drilling mud, for instance, that is spilled out after extraction and remains a jarring presence in the equatorial forest 30 years later. No longer the passive backdrop to human history, the landscape, nature, and matter itself turns to the fore and becomes the subject of aesthetic exploration. Here, the act of soil sampling is carried out as a mute forensic performance of handling the samplers, shovels, and giant pipettes of ecochemists, unearthing the smelling nightmare. He is enacting a scientific gesture, not in search of data this time, not a useful gesture, but one that enables matter to become expressive and deranging, acutely intensifying the provocations posed by the misplaced mud. The murky evidence brought to the surface speaks of the perishing of life worlds with whom the law has no relationship, and it speaks of an active materiality with which we want to reconnect. Artistic fieldwork of this performative kind sets out to activate the properties of each of these specific human-earth relations and turns them into a sensation that can be experienced later at the moment of exhibition. So the synchronized videos, it's a two-channel video projection piece, in their stereo optic exposes a landscape that is populated by all kinds of sentient beings who inhabit different dimensions of reality. Minute copper deposits, forest spirits, indigenous councils, scientists, medicinal plants, international law, global oil corporations, and river systems. And by addressing this complex ecology of practices, forest law delves into cosmopolitical considerations, the politics of humans, and everything else. Okay, thanks. That's as much as I'm going to present on this. And I head over to you. We are trying to look for the cursor. Where is it?
Thanks again, Ursula. I know this project so well, but it's really great to see it every time. It's really great work from both of you. Again, I thought I would take this chance to share with you a kind of project that I'm working on at the moment, but one that is nevertheless connected to a longer sort of body of work that has been unfolding for the past a couple of years, at least. But just a few words before, prior to that, as Marina was sort of suggesting, on, let's say, that also perhaps builds a certain relationship between particularly Paolo's work and mine, is that we're both working as part of this group that many of you might have heard of called Forensic Architecture. And here, architecture sort of is understood and is practiced as simultaneously as a way to produce spatial evidence on sort of crimes across various registers, from human rights violations to war crimes, to increasingly to environmental crimes, again at different scales, from the territory to even on a planetary scale, or moving from the body to the territory. But at the same time, it's also a sort of a project that sort of brings together many different practitioners from various disciplines, architecture, of course, inclusive of that, towards a kind of a research in the field of architecture or activism and filmmaking and curating, etc., that is aiming to where we've really tried to actually shift to a certain extent the discourse on what constitutes practicing architecture in the 21st century, where it's no longer a question of, again, sort of staying on this continuum of production or consumption, right? But rather as evidence, particularly. We're back. So particularly where we could sort of claim that the that we're at a time when, let's say, the era of the witness is in a court or legal political context is shifted also to the era of the evidence, of the material evidence. So when we actually see in Paolo and Ursula's research, and Ursula and Paolo's the video work, this act of the forensic sort of investigator sort of looking through the mud, is this notion that in a legal context, it is no longer only the case where it might be, you know, the expert witness or the witness sort of claiming this position of justice, but rather a mix of the cartography that sort of is acting from below, but also the very act of the material evidence itself, but also the witness. So it's altogether it's a project that there's many of us working across the world on different sites, and I want to sort of briefly sort of talk you through a project that I'm working on for the past several years. And this is, as I said in the beginning, was sort of a reason why I was very excited when this chance came up, or this invitation from Ursula to go together to Borneo. But in order to get there, I want to show you this diagram that was part of a. Actually, all these images are from an exhibition that I've just that is on at the moment at Akademie Schloss Solitude in Stuttgart. This particular one is as it says, is the unfolded ring of fire, the Pacific Ring. So the beginning in this part of I'll stand up and show you. So this is the Indonesian rainforest, and the Amazon is there. So we sort of start here, as you can see. There's this part of New Guinea that constitutes the Indonesian sort of belt. So along this entire area that sort of spans through the ocean and above the mountains, from Japan to the Alaska to the Kamchatka Peninsula, to the western United States, down to the Andes, through Central America, is this volcanic activity and sort of the seismic earthquake zone, right, that sort of folds all around the Pacific Ocean, and as such it sort of produces a kind of political geology in my view. But it is also precisely this tectonic zone, this zone of mineral activity, and this mineral violence that where one finds you know, gold and copper, silver, these metals and minerals that are the very sort of lubricant or objects of capitalism. And it is precisely along these front lines, this mineral frontier, that one can also trace conflict over land and over sea, on ocean and sea rights, with, in many cases, indigenous people and very big mining companies and the state. So the project sort of takes the Ring of Fire, and what we did is we just unfolded it, we just sort of cut it in half. And so where you begin to see the relationship between the landmines, which are all the dots in red, and the deep sea mines that are these huge blocks in the ocean, right? So immediately it is a different way to conceptualize or to spatially sort of understand this space, not only as an ocean space, but as a relation between the ocean and land. If you, for example, see this massive deep sea mining zone that's almost as big as the Amazon, right? And it is hardly known. But of course here the question of biodiversity enters big time, right? Because one thinks of the forest as this hugely important biodiverse place, such as the Amazon. But in the ocean, I mean, that's sort of another scale, because if we're talking about thousands of meters of depth, the kind of diverse biodiversity that's there. And this very idea that to sort of mine down there is totally crazy, right? If you think about it, that it's almost killing things that you never even came across. Is this audacity to sort of think in those terms? So I am now working for the past 3 years. At least on the very long-term conflict in West Papua, which, as I explained to you, is this militarized territory that's sort of just above Australia, and on the other side is Papua New Guinea. And the research has been, so I've been working with human rights NGOs, Papuan sort of independence leaders, environmental sort of activists, and many others, lawyers, architects, and many other sort of people to sort of slowly build up a case that would be considered a case of ecocide against the Indonesian state for the conflict in West Papua, which is simultaneously one that is about genocide and ecocide, because I could sort of give you a lot more context as to the conflict and so forth, but the very basis of this is that the United Nations, as you probably all know, the United Nations has a new Secretary General, the ex-president of Portugal, who ran UNHCR for many years, so it's an exciting time. So the UN was in fact the organization that was very much responsible for West Papuans to have lost their to the right to self-determination, as during this Cold War time, the Indonesian state was basically handed over this territory from being under a Dutch colonial rule to the West Papuan rule, and this is sort of an injustice that has sort of continued and until today. And the Papuan independence movement, who work very much diasporic, are constantly trying to bring this back to the international sort of table, in forums such as the UN. So for instance, this is a visualization of a report that was produced by the Asian Human Rights Council some years ago that. Very meticulously sort of tracked and even named victims of a campaign by the Indonesian military in the Papuan Highlands, which is again the highlands being really the, imagine, you know, the, if you follow my diagram of the Ring of Fire, that it's precisely this tectonic sort of force that comes out and sort of cuts the island across and goes towards the Philippines, right? So so it is precisely on this frontier where indeed sort of Papuan Highlanders were massacred over a 2-year period. Well, actually over many years, but this report actually focuses on this 2-year period. So the work that we did was to sort of visualize the report as to show precisely where the military sort of attacked from, how many were killed, where and how, and so forth. So very excited. I've actually been just put in contact with the person that wrote this report. So we will see where it goes. So this has been an important sort of work, I think, because if you read this report, although it's very, very sort of good, there's no maps, and it doesn't show you anywhere where any of these things took place. So I think precisely as what I sort of mentioned to you earlier about let's say the kind of what forensic architecture set out to do is this idea that if you are in a legal sort of context or that there should be an access to justice, right, where different groups, i.e. the non-state actors, the people that are actually struggling against power, against huge mining companies or the Ecuadorian state, and so forth, might be able to mobilize the, you know, the same sort of or similar caliber of evidence, right? With the caveat, I mean, this could be a parenthesis in a much longer conversation, that bringing, let's say, in certain cases, indigenous knowledge into cartographies is also a kind of violence, right? So one has to be aware of this, and this is sort of an ongoing sort of conversation, and so forth. So but after so following the sequence of the work that we did, the second sort of investigation is one that brings this historical question of genocide, what happened to the Papuans in the 70s and 60s, to the present, right? Because it was precisely after Indonesian state takes control of West Papua that the world's biggest combined gold and copper mining company sort of starts up operations in the Papuan Highlands, in the very area where the genocide took place. And this is the Grasberg mine. It's one of the biggest, baddest mines on the planet that is producing some of the world's cheapest copper, but it's in a totally remote place. So it's very, very difficult to get to or to for people to access and so forth. In fact, the Indonesian military and the mining company have very close ties, to the extent that you are, it's very, very difficult to even get to this place. Which brings me to another point what we're trying to sort of achieve in forensic architecture is precisely looking at conflict zones, which are very difficult to go to, right? So how does human rights reporting in the 21st century find new ways of reporting on conflicts, where it's just simply not easy just to go there and, you know, forget about the swashbuckling sort of image of the war, you know, war photographer, you know, sort of, you know, running around and drinking whiskey in bars and so on. But it's just, you know, it's a different sort of context, right? So where satellite images are become very useful. So satellite images, of course, or remote sensing, really is a technology that's really been around since the mid early 70s. That begins with the U.S. weather sort of the NOAA sort of setting off these satellites called the Landsat program, which goes around to really scan the planet, right? And mainly, not really for military purposes, that's a different sort of thing altogether, but really to understand the planet, to sense its constitution, right, from this planetary scale, for agriculture and various other meteorological and agricultural sort of purposes. So this mine, since the 80s, has been So the mining company has been actually dumping just a tremendous amount of toxic waste into this river system that flows to the Arafura Sea, which is the sea that is sort of separates Australia to New Guinea, which, by the way, was actually one landmass a long time ago. So I worked with several remote sensing scientists to sort of on this project to produce what is in our view the most sort of comprehensive report that shows the landscape history of this contamination, right? I want to maybe just quickly take your attention to, let's say, these white sort of structures that we sort of drew on top of the contamination. And this really shows an attempt by the mining company to build levees to sort of stop the contamination sort of from moving downstream. And one can sort of relate the amount of which we all sort of gathered based on available corporate data on the amount of sort of mine tailings that were sort of coming out of this at each period, and what point they built the levees, and what point the levees sort of were breached, and what point this toxic stuff started to go into the sea. So it starts to imagine, if you sort of imagine the this massive open pit mine as a kind of wound, right? That really, it's a cheap metaphor. I'm sorry, but it works. You know, that you have this massive wound and that is sort of slowly bleeding over 40 years, right? How does one sort of hold a situation like this? This company or the Indonesian state accountable for something that's so long term and that's so something that's so hidden, right? And this is cutting this toxic line, a very thick one, through tropical forest that is again home to just innumerable sort of species that are not known to us and where hundreds of languages are spoken, right? This idea that sort of ethnic diversity and biodiversity are really, you know, one and the same. I have one more sort of project to show you, and then we can sort of move on to a wider discussion. Is that I don't know if you can see, but what this shows, for instance, is it's small, I'm sorry, but what this shows is these different colors, again, just keep it in your mind. So those different colors, again, sort of show how the forest, the rate of deforestation, right, that was taking place in this particular area that's about 100, it's really short, the distance, about 130 square kilometers. And what this really shows is that this is 1990, for instance, and this is 2014. So we had a 20-year study period. Since 1990 to 2014, the deforestation rates actually peaked, but then they went down, which is strange because while at the same time we analyzed the output of the mining company and its tailings, in fact, because of global copper prices never really went down and so forth, the copper output really just continued to stay very high. So it produces a very simple argument, but that's very spatial at the same time, and that sort of is sort of built on this evidence, right? That while deforestation rates went down, the mine tailings kept going up. So they're not simply just disappearing, right? So where are they going? So this brings us to the last sort of inset analysis. This has been done by Mike Alonso, who's been working at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center with me, is that we could on the other hand show that over time, again, from the 90s until the present, the if you sort of compare the mouth of the river as a sort of a outlet for sedimentation to sort of come out into, that over this period that the mouth of the river of the estuary rather, that is directly in relationship to where the flow of the mine tailings come, it is in fact there's much more stuff in the water, right? If you sort of correlate this in relationship to the analysis that we did on the deforestation rates and the mine tailing, we can start to see that there is this very clear correlation between these two sets of data and analysis. This is again a report that we've just completed or published with a journal called Scientific Reports, but at the same time this will be sort of going towards this case that I'm building. The last project in this series that I want to sort of talk to you very briefly.
Maybe
just 2 minutes. Yeah. Is one that's not in the mountain zones, but rather closer to the coast. Again, I'm not sure if you can see it from here, but it's really a flatland. And this has been earmarked by the Indonesian state because it's very flat and it's very, very green. It's just forests, you know, like really dense forests. This has been earmarked by the Indonesian state to be for this mega industrial scale sort of agriculture project. I heard agriculture was something that was a topic yesterday, which I sadly have missed. But this is of course again like the rest of West Papua, sort of indigenous territory, and what we're sort of attempting to do here is to show the various concession blocks that have been sort of put forward by various sort of palm oil plantation companies, for instance, and so forth. And it sort of zooms in on several cases that relate to a very specific particular case. The one that I have, I can talk to you very, very quickly here, is one where we see in the first, this is again a sort of analysis over a long time, that once shows that in this 100 square kilometer sort of block, that that belonged to this very specific peoples, the Mahuze, the peoples. Eventually, in the 90s, begins this encroachment of these massive transmigration programs that is bringing sort of poor people from Java and other parts of Indonesia to sort of the outline, the frontier zones of the forests. As a kind of like a planning, as a kind of violent tool. But then later on you see when the palm oil plantation comes, it is in fact inhabiting the very area of the transmigration zones. And we see the forest, which is, the village, which is sort of around here, sort of in a kind of very similar to a tactic that you'd see by the military where they're pushing from different sides, cornering the victim, right? You see, they're being sort of pushed from north by a toxic sort of river from a palm oil company, but on from the south side, this encroachment that is over time a palm oil plantation, and so on. So this is all ongoing work that is going towards a project that I've set up called the Inter-Pacific Ring Tribunal that is at the moment working with. TBA 21 and Foundation as one of the partners to sort of set up a series of tribunals, right, that will work with and with hopefully many, many people to set up following a kind of people's tribunal, a series of cases where this forensic architecture can be sort of examined and possibly work towards or work with existing legal cases. So I think that's all for me for today. Thank you.
I haven't seen many of these finished maps yet. It's great. And also there are lots of overlaps with the situation in Ecuador and probably Chile and other places as well. But I think we'll open it now for discussion with all of you. Or did you want to moderate a little bit, Mariella?
I'll try.
Yes, come over here.
We also...
I think, well, I'm probably just a little bit more advanced as I know your text book, which is just something quite similar. You were introducing the piece we are going to see later. The Biosynthetic Borneo, which is a brand new piece of yours, which is a pleasure to have you here. And we started to talk about it yesterday, and it was very interesting to talk about Jakob von Uexküll and his concept of Umwelt or milieu. He is describing the coexistence of species, which together create something like music, as if everything was kind of written in the nature, right? And there is a character in the video who is a scientist, which I thought, okay, maybe he's not a scientist, but he can be an actor probably, but it doesn't matter. I think what I like is that the nature and the scientist is not kind of a conflicting thing, but the video balances somehow the natural sciences concept with human sciences and all these things. Well, my question to you yesterday was if kind of an approach to Jakob von Uexküll, who died I think 1944, it's quite an old concept. He wrote this, we saw probably in the 1930s, right? So I was just thinking, I was very much interested, what do biologists think about artistic concepts like this when we are somewhere in the middle? Because not that every time science and art kind of find their match or find their meet themselves harmoniously. So I just want to repeat this question because I raised yesterday because I was so much interested in that. I want to put out the feedbacks from the scientific field.
Well, this you might have to ask scientists, you know, how they feel about it. I mean, it happened that this Dayak man is a scientist himself, and I thought that's also the reason why he was very good for this performance. But it was always clear that it was a performance, and that he was particularly interested in contributing to an art project. Then just another NGO visit to the field where you actually do the classical work of, you know, finding out how life functions in the forest. But his scientific work had a lot to do with mapping, so it's not so unlike what you're doing, maybe, in a different level. And I don't know if it makes so much sense to actually separate these two practices so much, because we're all into signifying systems, reproducing meaning of sorts and forms of interpretation. Therefore, there's a lot of overlapping going on in the first place. So, I mean, Descola also speaks about this in the interview you did with him. I mean, this is at the forefront of many people's concerns, because science has been so much. Scientists have defined the way we think and what we know about nature, and And so it's only natural that we would start engaging with these practices more in the arts and other forms of meaning production, anthropology or whatever. So
I mean, I would slightly shift it a little bit to maybe talk about image production, right? Which is again something that's, in fact, on the other hand, artists claim to have ownership of, and in fact, which is simply not the case, right? So, on a very simple level, right? Scientists are also constantly, you know, making producing images that is completely part of the very analysis that they do, depending on what it is that they do. But also, let's say you have a, again, in relationship to the work that I do, let's say in the case of sort of what is an admissible piece of evidence in a courtroom, right? I mean, I studied, for instance, the history of toxicology, right? As a sort of one of the moments where forensic science sort of enters the courtroom. And there, it really it's a fascinating sort of tale, right? Where you in fact have chemists sort of having to bring into visibility a poison like arsenic, right, in the courtroom, not exactly using their own methods, right? A test tube and a beaker and a bit of the gut, right, as opposed to a paint and a canvas, which even then, if you think about like how paint was made before sort of industrial capitalism, right? It's sort of made from all sorts of odd things, right? So kind of alchemical in many ways. But you know, here there were these chemists, right, in the 19th century, first time, you know, they're all of a sudden they're having to produce something that's has color and that has something that is sort of, you know, visible in the courtroom, right? And it's precisely this point where a judgment has to be made from the perspective of the judge on the basis of aesthetics, right? But one which is nevertheless deadly serious.
I was just coming to my mind, because I think there are certain stereotypes describing the scientific and the intuitive as something conflicting, while we don't have to put it like this. So I don't know, because you started with the new piece, and then we saw some previous works of yours, which was great. And I think what's about Borneo, what is also the biosynodic Borneo we are going to see in a while, is that you really exploit the same area as Anand Singh, the famous ethnographer and anthropologist, who has actually also a good connection to our Friday's talk, because we will have her on the pole with Jennifer. I don't know. Maybe But that's great. But I think you, in a way, you was it kind of a because she was exploring that area, because it was one of the white points on the map, as you mentioned, where there is not much influence of the civilized or Western culture. But at times she was exploring it, and when she wrote this Diamond Queen and think that researched in that area, learned languages, talked to people. So this is some decades ago. I think everything changed there. But was it that it was a challenge to visit specifically this part of the planet because of this preview, because it's so well known, being one of the intact places or something of fame would be something.
Well, the more pristine forest is really at the heart of Borneo, where it's very, very difficult to get to. That's where all these new explorations go these expeditions go, you know, to find new species. So that's way further in. Actually, the area of the Meratus Mountains is very accessible. You know, it's from the south, so it's the area that is more populated around it. So, no, actually, I didn't think that was such an issue. It was, we went there because this NGO was active there, and we needed a way in, and an organization to collaborate with, and that would allow us to go somewhere and to be introduced to the people there.
Yeah. Just to pick up on that a little bit, I think this question of intact and not intact is matters, because I mean, for instance, and this was, I was resisting this a little bit, but in the beginning, but I think it was really great that we did it. To actually try to go a place where, you know, it wasn't just sort of logged and completely, you know, destroyed and so on. Well, there was still a patch of forest, you know, where we could go and somehow I think this was it was really the good thing, especially since so much of let's say well certainly the work I'm doing is really about, you know, about sort of environmental violence. You know, it's not to really say that I want to see what it's like when it's all pristine. I mean, there isn't really anything pristine as it's probably has been, it's one of the mantras of the festival, you know, there's no nature, etc. But yeah, I think I don't know, felt like a good decision to sort of go to this part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I would like to hear a bit from the audience.
Me too, because yeah, they have remarks.
Yes, go ahead. Jennifer, you were...
I just was curious, Nabila, about your sound work in collaboration with
I did actually.
Next question.
Okay. Who else? Yes, Margarita.
Maybe it's a thought, not so much a question, but relates to everything that you said. First, I was wondering how the tribunal project is going, where will it be based, and how will it function? Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about that in relation with deep sea mining and with production of imagery, which is something that you're talking about, because right now in Portugal I'm trying to devise strategies to fight deep sea mining that they want to start in the Azores.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm in touch with Filipe on that. Filipe has done when we were in the expedition.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm trying to devise tools of how to approach this subject that is, like, you know, it's on a planetary scale in terms of agreements and so on. So I feel quite restless, but I don't know how to produce evidence of loss in advance of something that is like on deep sea level. So I want to know a little bit about how you think that we can work this legally.
Yeah. Well, we're quite fortunate to be working with a scientist from the International Seabed Authority, who is, he's a really amazing guy. He's also kind of an activist. Like, he's sort of working there, but at the same time very, very aware of the threats and so on. We're also working with Davor Vidas, who is one of the leading international lawyers on laws of the sea. But in terms of let's say, I mean, I follow you. I mean, we're kind of in a similar situation, right? But what one of the things that I'm working towards is a case study that was a research project that was done by German scientists in the. In the Peru Basin, in not far from the Galapagos, they sort of over many years they sort of tested this huge area to sort of mimic what deep sea mining what impact it would have. So I think so this is a research center that's been doing this in Germany, and I'm very curious. We have some contacts with them, so we're trying to see. Yeah, I want to sort of be able to work with this data, if possible, right? Or to even know, you know, what that is. But it's precisely this this almost this imperceptibility and this depth and this not knowing, you know, what's down there, right? That I think, again, our friend who interviewed us this morning asked a pointed question. He said, "Well, about Ursula's work, is it evidence what you do, right?" And I'm just picking up on what you said, because you said that we're going to continue in the this afternoon. So in a sense, perhaps, no, I leave it to you, no, to think that. Is it that that in such a case, no, it's the deep depth, it's the depth of the sea, where there really is no way to go down there, right? Not even if you have $1 billion. And you don't even know what's down there, or what will be the future, you know. That there's other ways, right? I can think of one. Literature, right? Other ways of evidencing this that wasn't a legal scientific sort of approach. I mean, I say this only, you know, with a what's the expression, a dash of salt or something like this, because I mean, my intention is to sort of see if it is possible, right?
But you know, the situation that we encountered in the Amazon when interviewing a botanist who has been doing
the American
field recording for 30 years. He has actually done, he is the guy who did the condor, the Cordillera del Condor, you know. He's been going there walking with indigenous people and just kind of collected all these new species that nobody knew about, and he's still doing this. But he's also saying that because botanists started to go in there and start collecting specimens and so on, it's also a way into this forest, and then other people follow, and then pipelines are being built and roads are being built. And at the same time, you kind of find new species, but you also document the end of these species, because it's the beginning of the destruction of that area. And so it's a very bittersweet task that he has to do there.
And I think it's nice that you mentioned about the... I saw footage of this guy. It's brilliant. I mean, it's in your...
Yeah, film. He's pretty amazing. And actually, it has... it's a very similar situation than you described at the Pacific Rim, because the condor is a mountain chain that lies between the high Andes and the Amazonian lowland. And you have a very special biodiversity on the Andes, and a very special one in the Amazon, and where they meet in this cordillera, they merge and just create a completely insane diversity there. And that's why 70% of new species that are going to be discovered in the future are located there. You know, that's where they're looking for them. And that had to do with the tectonic clash that happened there, you know, these big shifts of the kind of Caribbean plate and then the Andean plate, and where they crashed created this huge friction or clash and created this biodiversity. But for the same tectonic reasons, you have the mineral wells on the ground. And this is the first time in history where they start to be in competition. You can either get to the mineral diversity and richness, or you can save the biodiversity on the surface. And so that's the clash we're in.
But Margarita, I was just thinking that, I mean, in the in the context of the Pacific, what we're sort of learning is that there's a again that it's not like some blanket ocean, which, you know, like people have been using this ocean for millennia, right? And they have all of these sort of tools and knowledge, right, from celestial navigation to sort of to the way they build their boats and many other ways. And so, you know, if something is wrong, no, I mean, they sort of also have ways of sort of possibly having clues. I mean, in the case of Portugal, is fishermen, are they, would that be of interest to speak to them for you?
It used to be fishing communities, mostly mm-hmm. like whale hunters, mm-hmm. until, you know, whale hunting was abolished. Right now it's a geostrategic area for mm-hmm. contact with the American, with the Air Force and so on, mm-hmm. because we're in the middle of the Atlantic, so it's so useful. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, it's kind of, you know, remote Atlantida.
All oh, right. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
But what they're saying is that they will be looking into this kind of minerals and different resources that they can apply to renewable energy. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, the excuse that they're using is like to build wind turbines and so on. We need to come here and like, dig this. But yeah, if you go there, it's like incredible the level of biodiversity that we don't have in the continent, but in the islands,
isolated
and so on.
Yeah.
But it's But maybe you could talk a little bit more about the tribunals.
Oh, yes. Well, actually, I didn't talk enough. I mean, and there was no time, really. But, there's a... I mean, it's all sort of in the process. I mean, there's a... I cannot give away too much at the moment, okay. unless certain things are already in place. But the West Papua case will be the first one. Because it's the one that I know the most about. But it really, you know, to a certain extent, came from partly the fact that the Papuan politicians that I've been sort of working with have made a lot of progress. So West Papua, the United Liberation Movement for West Papua has been recognized as of late last year, as a observer, they received observer status for the Melanesian Spearhead Group. So it's so the idea is that they really consider themselves, you know, or they are, you know, Melanesian, a Pacific, you know, islander people, rather than anything to do with Javanese, you know, or Indonesians. So there's a kind of like a unity and a kind of movement, right, towards this political project, which you might say is very, very, very difficult, but it is a horizon, right? A friend of mine, Marco Armiro, who's an environmental historian, sort of was telling me that you know, like, I mean, the point is the struggle also, no? Like, it's a horizon, so there's no reason to sort of give up. I'm just sort of sketching out some people that I want to work with to sort of set this up. But the idea is really that it would be a simultaneously a mock trial, right? But that is simultaneously heavily involves sort of legal people towards a kind of legal research.
But I think these mock trials, they are really important because with the nature rights, they also did this International Tribunal of Nature Rights, mm-hmm. where they take corporations to trial who have committed ecocide. And I think it creates a language, it creates a practice. It got a lot of attention at COP21 in Paris. And people start to get used to the idea that nature rights are being fought for like we used to fight for human rights. Mm-hmm. So I think that these are very important examples to make something public and enter the minds of people. And for us in the arts, I mean, maybe this is very particular of this forensic architecture project that you actually you actually dare to just enter the real space and start acting upon the legal structures and mm-hmm. political situations, whereas you know, someone like me, I don't have that. I don't have that claim. I did forest law because I think it's interesting and really important to speculate with the possibility of thinking about the universal nature rights, for instance. It's a philosophical project for me, not so much one that wants to kind of either speak for indigenous nations because I feel they don't have a voice, or for other kind of, or to put corporations on trial, you know. But I think the range between these different practices mm-hmm. is fantastic now. You know, you have so many ways of acting in the visual imagination and collective imagination about these topics.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, it's this idea that. That forensic science is usually in the service of law of the state, and that and it need not be, right? I mean, we are all sort of censors in many ways,
an activist
right?
Tool. Yeah. Yeah.
So you know, like I mean, people are. Well, one can argue, like, what is that really? What's the impact, right? But you know, everybody has a mobile phone, so you know, like, people are, you know, you go in the United States, and you know, you actually have. All these images and videos of white cops killing young black men, right? Young African Americans. And okay, it still continues. So I mean, this is something that is, you know, ongoing. But there's this sort of possibility, right? That
creating evidence, sure. Yes, you have been wanting.
Yes, sorry. I just wanted. But is there also a kind of a difference when this chief was talking? I mean, it is the idea of the commons that has traditionally been there. I'm talking about this bringing the forest to the court, this legalistic kind of approach. I can see we may need whatever approach is available, but this idea of caretaking and stewardship and the forest as a commons is still quite different towards an idea of, you know, I own this land and so I sue somebody. Because I think also in the majority of cases, probably indigenous people do not own the land in a legal kind of sense. So I'm asking about also the limits of those kinds of practices that you're talking about.
Well, in this case, they do own indigenous nations. Anyway, these different nations own their territory, and they didn't only fight in the legal battle, but they also did life and peace and life camps in these different locations where they risked to enter the territory. So they did a lot of kind of silent, peaceful demonstration in that sense, and. Although Ecuador has the rights of nature inscribed in their constitution, they couldn't sue in Ecuador, but they had to go to the Inter-American Court, and there, of course, they do not recognize the rights of nature. So the actual ruling of the case was on basis of the invasion of indigenous land, which is basically invading a common territory. It was based on property rights. As you said, you know, and of course that is something that legal experts critiqued afterwards. They said it would have been better if it was argued along the lines of the vita digna, kind of a dignified life, so it would be closer to human rights. Because with property rights, okay, they invaded now, they got them out, but on the next occasion, because of the jurisdiction on the surface, which is owned by the indigenous communities, but the subsoil is owned by the state. If it contains minerals of strategic national importance, the state can claim the minerals. In Europe, this is like that as well, since the Second World War. And so this is the problem. It is a conflictual jurisdiction, as this map of Paolo actually shows very well. And in that sense, yeah. But this is why I'm interested in this, in these cases, because property rights, human rights, and nature rights, they describe three very different forms of relating to nature. And whatever wins is actually going to be the example for future cases and guide our minds about how we think about these relationships. And that's why it's important. We are really at a very interesting moment in time, conceptually speaking, because in real life, of course, it's the corporations that gain more and more rights and not at all the nature.
The PG is at the plants and the animals, and they have representatives in politics and parliament. It's not actually, it's a quote from Philip Descola, and because he is like mentioning it that they can't defend themselves. But I just like the direct way he said.
Any other comments and questions and inputs?
Yeah, I have just a little question concerning what you said about this shift from like a documentary whiskey drinking photographers to this satellite imagery. And I was thinking, and the question is maybe a little bit speculative, whether there's a use of like sound recordings and sound-related research in forensics, or whether you do things like that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, in our group, there's Lawrence Abu Hamdan, who's a sound artist. He's been doing fantastic work on this field for many years. The last project that he was involved in the forensic architecture has been working with Amnesty International for a couple of years now, and this last project was to sort of reconstruct a Syrian black site, a Syrian sort of terror prison where nobody's ever seen the inside of what it looks like, and thousands of people have died there and completely extra legally and so on. We worked with Amnesty to reconstruct what this prison looked like, and there's an interactive website that you can go to where you can actually sort of walk through the prison, and you hear the interviews with people that were there, but you can actually see the entire thing, you know, what the whole space was done. I mean, a reconstruction of it. And here, Lawrence did a really fantastic work where he was, because imagine, no, like you're sort of in prison and it's semi-dark or completely dark, so you cannot really see very much, but your hearing ability really, you know, would sort of improve, right? I'm kind of like trying to articulate it, what the project did. I wasn't part of this this one. But what they did was to actually, for instance, play different sounds to some of the survivors, and these sounds where you would actually the sounds would sort of give you a sense of the length and the width and how big the rooms were, right? Or distances, right? So, because you're sort of in this horrible place, absolutely terrifying place for years, right? You're able to, again, to a certain amount of probability, right? In this case, say that, well, actually, no, it sounds a little bit further that way, or it's a bit closer here, you know, or that's, I think, is the length of, you know, I think that's where the guards were sitting, you know, and so on, you know. because I could hear them, you know, walking back and all of these sort of things. So then it was possible, right, based on these sort of these ear witness, as Lawrence calls it, possible to reconstruct, right, this some of these dimensions and translate them from the oral to the spatial. I've started. We've started a new project in again in Borneo, which is among a few other places, that is trying to build a case with the Baltazar Garzon Foundation against the Indonesian state for the forest fires that took place there in the last couple of years, especially last year. So I'm working with a primatologist, an anthropologist who sort of specializes in primates, particularly the orangutan, and to sort of produce evidence that they've been working on that could again possibly stand up in a court. I mean, it's quite speculative in that sense, but based on this notion that the orangutan is able to speak, right? That again, you know, like who was here saying that, well, quoting Descola, that they cannot speak and, you know, they cannot. But in the case of, let's say, the orangutan, the closest relative to us, in fact, what primatologists have been sort of working on is closing the gap, this evolutionary gap, right? To in fact say, to claim, for instance, that the orangutan, you know, at a very kind of a basic level, right? But by basic, I don't mean less developed, but I just mean, you know, at a different sort of stage, not to do with what's, you know, better or worse, because language is as violent as anything. So that they were actually using is the only primate, right? Is using both vowels and consonants when it sort of speaks, right? So it may not be, you know, like what we're saying, but it's sort of like human language. And the idea is that the case is built on the orangutan rights, not as an animal right, but closer to a human right. We are presenting this case at the Istanbul Design Biennial that opens very soon. And there's a really fascinating case, if you're interested, that is called On Sandra, who was an orangutan that was locked up in a zoo in Argentina, in Buenos Aires. And legal activists in Argentina were able to actually claim that the orangutan was human enough, and that they actually mobilized the same kind of activist tactics that they used, that they were used to using to help locate the disappeared, you know, during the dictator regime in Argentina, right? To actually mobilize those similar legal tactics, along with sort of scientific evidence, to be able to get finally a habeas corpus, right, for the ape, for Sandra, which legally said that they could get a release for this ape from the zoo, not because it was an ape, but, you know, because we have to, you know, conserve or love this ape, but that it had a right.
Good. Shall we call it a day and move over to the?
It's exactly.
It's 6 o'clock, and unless you have some other urgent questions, but we are around for a while, and we can always continue a little bit one-to-one. So, thanks for coming.
Yeah, thank you.